Now, data storytelling is such a buzzword, but what does it actually mean and why is it so important? Just the other day, I was talking to a recruiter who said something that really stuck with me. She said, in the age of AI, the analysts who stand out are those who have a strong personal brand, and that often comes out in how they tell stories with data. So today I'm going to share with you 5 storytelling strategies that are going to immediately elevate your portfolio projects and the way that you show up in interviews. And one of them is so easy that you're going to want to apply it right away. If you're new here, I'm Christine. I'm a data director turned mentor. And on this channel, I share the communication skills, analytical frameworks, and business intuition to help you stand out as a data analyst. If that sounds helpful to you, make sure to subscribe and let's dive in. So let's start with what great data storytelling isn't. It is not linear information where you're walking people through every step that you took in chronological order. It is not a technical flex where you're sharing the SQL queries, the code that you wrote, and sharing the formulas that you use to show that you worked hard. And it is not a data dump where you're overwhelming your audience with every single metric, visualization, and value and insight that you found. Instead, great data storytelling is tailored. You're speaking directly to what your audience actually cares about, their metrics, their business goals, and their questions. And it's selective, where you're picking the visualizations and the data points that actually matter to your core message. And it's interpretive, where you're sharing the meaning, not the mechanics. Think about it this way. When your friend goes on a date, they don't say, I put on my shoes, I walked out the door, I walked down the corner, and we met for a coffee, and we had a conversation. Instead, they might say something like, we had an amazing conversation, and I could immediately tell that something was different. That's actually storytelling. They're getting right to the point and explaining the so what of what happened. And this is the difference between being seen as just a technical resource who can write code versus being an analyst who can really help your stakeholders and who a hiring manager needs on their team. So now let's unlock the 5 strategies to great data storytelling. One of the lowest hanging fruits to improving your visual data storytelling is in paying attention to your data to ink ratio. The data to ink ratio is a concept that describes how much necessary data elements you're showing compared to unnecessary ink, or in this case, pixels, you're using on other things. So for example, if I start out with a visualization that looks something like this, which a lot of default Excel visualizations look like, I want to get rid of the unnecessary ink. So get rid of grid lines, get rid of tick marks, get rid of extra decimal points that aren't necessary to the high level story. And definitely please get rid of thick outlines, 3D effects, and shadows. Then you also want to make sure that all necessary elements are really clearly readable. So your labels, your titles, and your axes. And just by these simple tweaks, you can create a visualization that looks exec ready. This is one of the most common mistakes I see in portfolio projects. I see a lot of visualizations and dashboards that are barely readable. And instead they focus a lot on extra colors, tick marks, and grid lines that aren't actually necessary to the story. If your dashboard, for example, has a low data to ink ratio, you are likely hiding the so what behind all of these decorative elements. You can see that if you compare this dashboard to this other one, where they're showing the same exact data, but one of them is much more clear because it has a high data to ink ratio, and that brings the story to the surface. So this next strategy is essential if you're working with any high-level stakeholders, so people who are directors, VPs, C-suite, or basically anyone who doesn't have the time to interpret your charts for you. And the rule is really simple. It's to use headlines, not titles. A title is just something that describes a chart, whereas a headline is what tells the actual story. When you're just using descriptive titles, you're actually leaving the analytical heavy lifting to the viewer. But you're the analyst. You're the one who should actually be helping to shape that narrative. So let's compare these two. We have sales revenue by month versus sales surge by 30% during the peak COVID years and have since experienced all-time lows and continue to decline. Now, the second one tells the VP instantly what they need to know, when it happened, and why they should care. You can also even add small callouts to the graph to call out the spikes and the downturns so that the story is clear at a glance. And the same thing applies when you're talking in interviews or you're at work. So you wouldn't say something like, here's a bar chart where we're looking at sales over time, and then that's it. You would say, in this chart looking at sales over time, we've seen sales spike during COVID years, but since then it's continued to decline, and even looking at more recent data, we see the same pattern. So this is something we would want to look into even more. Using headlines instead of titles is one of the easiest ways to bring the story to life, both visually and verbally. Now, on the job, you're gonna be talking to lots of different kinds of people, from data engineers and data analysts who nerd out on different kinds of SQL joins to sales directors whose eyes literally glaze over if you say the word confidence interval. These people are not expecting the same level of detail. So one of the biggest storytelling skills you should build is calibrating the degree of detail you share with your audience. Think of it like a gradient. There are the people who are really technical, then there are people who are medium technical level, and then there are the people who are the least technical. So it basically moves from tell me everything to tell me the highlights to please don't make my brain hurt. So let me show you what this actually sounds like. For people who are really technical, so other data engineers or data analysts, you might explain the results of an experiment or an A/B test with something like variation A had a p-value of 0.05, so it was statistically significant at the 95% confidence interval. This lift was primarily driven by people in the free trial segment who seemed to interact with the customer story section the most. Then for people who are of medium technical level, so let's say product managers or marketing managers, you might explain the same results with something like variation A performed better than variation B by 20%. The differentiating factor was mostly in free trial users interacting with customer story section more. And then for the people who are less technical, so let's say directors or VPs, you might just skip to the end and say something like, the version with the customer story section outperformed the version that just focused on benefits. It showed us that people are more interested in the personal touch than looking at the features. Now here's a twist that many candidates don't know. Hiring managers are often in the medium bucket, so they want clarity and they also want the numbers, but if you go full engineer mode on them, they will probably start to tune out. And your stakeholders are likely in the less technical bucket. And the more you can show that you understand degrees of detail thinking, the more you're gonna look like someone who can operate inside of a real team, not just inside a Kaggle notebook. So before any interview, any presentation, any stakeholder meeting, ask yourself, what degree of detail does this person actually want? And it's not about dumbing things down. It's about having understanding and empathy for the person who's on the other side. This is actually something that we teach in the Analytics Accelerator Mentorship Program, and it's one of the biggest things that helps our students land their jobs. Now, one of the biggest mistakes that I see of new analysts is thinking that they're sharing insights when they're actually just reporting. Back when I used to give take-home assessments to candidates for a data analyst job, we'd give them a SaaS sales data set and we'd ask them to surface some insights and recommendations. And every single round, we'd have candidates respond with something like, the average order value in December was $340 compared to the average order value in January, which was $390. And they just stop there. And as a hypothetical stakeholder, I'd be left wondering, is that good? Is it bad? Should I panic or should I just go grab a coffee? There's no interpretation, there's no context and no point of view. So interpretation is where you bring two essential things. The first is business context, so why the numbers relate back to the stakeholder questions and goals. And the second is your perspective, your interpretation of what the numbers mean and why they're important. The candidate we ended up hiring explained the same data like this. The AOV in December was 30% lower than the AOV in January, which is actually pretty surprising considering the fact that December actually had a higher number of the sales of the premium product. But this is likely driven down by the holiday sales, so this might not be a red flag, but it's something that we would want to look into further. You can see the difference, right? This is someone who's actually analyzing, not someone who's just stared at a spreadsheet. So here's how you can tell the difference. Reporting sounds like, here are the numbers, whereas interpretation sounds like, this is a red flag or this is a green flag because I found this really surprising or I found this really interesting, or this is normal or abnormal because, or my hypothesis is, or I suggest that we look into. These phrases show that you're actually thinking like an analyst, and they also earn stakeholder trust because they show that you can help them actually make sense of the numbers. Everyone can report what the values are, but very few people can help people understand what they mean. So whenever you're in a stakeholder meeting or you're sharing your insights for a take-home project, just remember to ask yourself, are you sharing information or are you sharing your interpretation? Now, one of the best ways that you can create value as a data analyst is in helping other teams make decisions. For example, what marketing campaign should we run? Should we ship this new product? Should we still make free trials available to new users? But many new analysts stop short of this action. They're afraid to suggest the actual next step. In my work, the best data analysts I've worked with would always take it one step further after their insights and end their stories with actual recommendations on next steps. So for example, instead of stopping at January had a higher AOV than December, you would say something like, January AOV was higher than in December, and this is mostly because of the holiday promotions that we ran. However, the higher volume of orders in December did not actually make up for the lower revenue compared to January. So we might want to refine our strategy for these holiday promotions moving forward. And this is the perfect perfect way to tie up your narrative about what's happening in the numbers, and then toss the ball back to your stakeholders, where you then collaborate on what steps to take next. Now, notice that I'm not pretending like there's one perfect answer, and my job isn't to come up with a final solution, but instead, I should suggest some initial next steps to keep the conversation going. If you want a step-by-step framework for how to think about insights and recommendations, I actually just talked about this in my last video, which you can check out here. So if you want more practical, useful tips like this on how to become a standout data analyst, then check out my newsletter below, where I'm sharing weekly tips on communication skills, business intuition, and analytical frameworks so that you can think like a standout analyst. And the next time you're working on a portfolio project or prepping for an interview, come back to these storytelling strategies. Thank you for spending your time with me today, and I'll see you in the next one.